Good day students, today we are going to begin with alkynes. Alkynes are the hydrocarbons, those who have a triple bond between the two carbon atoms. Now these hydrocarbons are also unsaturated and they are also called olefins. You already know the meaning of olefins, the compounds which form oil-like products, especially with halogens. So that is why they are called olefins. Now as compared to alkanes and alkenes, alkynes are the most reactive. This is because one bond between the carbon atom is a strong one and the other two are weak ones. So more the weaker bonds in the molecule, the less stronger the molecule will be. So this also makes the alkynes or the all alkynes very, very highly reactive. Now the general formula of all alkynes is CnH2n-2. That means if you know the number of carbon atoms, say 3, so hydrogen atoms will be twice the number of carbon atoms, 3 2s are 6, and minus 2, so that will be 4. So the moment you look at this formula in a hydrocarbon, you know that it is an alkyne. So this is the general formula. The first member of the homologous series of alkynes is called ethyne. Ethyne is C2H2 2s are 4 minus 2 2. Ethyne, this is the IUPAC name. The common name of this compound is acetylene. Now this name acetylene, though it is a common name, but it is so popular and it is so commonly accepted that everything related to the triple bond is referred to as acetylene. For example, the entire homologous series of alkynes is known as acetylenic series. The triple bond is referred to as acetylenic linkage. So generally when you're writing the common names also, then rather than using any other name, wherever there is a triple bond, they use the term acetylene. I will just tell you. The next member in the series is C3H4. The IUPAC name is propyne. And the common name is methyl acetylene. Methyl acetylene. Now, why is it so called? Because if you look at the structure, it is CH3C triple bond. Okay, this is the structure. So this is referred to as acetylene, and because this is the methyl group, CH3 is a methyl group, so that is why I told you the common names don't have a logic, but I'm telling you so that you may remember it like this. It is called methyl acetylene. So acetylene, wherever there is a triple bond, and this attachment is given the name of methyl. So it is called methyl acetylene. Initially, earlier, it was also called propylene. Propylene. Now don't be carried away by this name, because this is a common name. The rules of IUPAC don't apply to the common names. Alright. So propylene is a common name. Why it is so called? There is no reason behind it. Then the next member is C4H6. It is called butyne. Now, if you look at the structural formula of butyne, it can be 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. We can have a triple bond over here. We can also have a triple bond over here. Now, this will have 2 hydrogen atoms. This will have no hydrogen atoms. This one will have 1. So this is going to have 3, no, none, and this will also have 3. So how many carbon atoms? 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, and 6 hydrogen atoms. 3, 4, 5, and 1, 6. Here also 3 and 3, 6. So both of them are the same structures. Only the placement of the triple bond is different. When you're writing the name of this compound, you call it 1-butyne. 1 means you're just telling the position of the triple bond. Bute because there are 4 carbon atoms, and ine because there is a presence of a triple bond. Now this one will be referred to as, we will number the carbon atoms 1, 2, 3, 4. The triple bond is between carbon atom 2 and 3, out of which 2 is a smaller number. So the name will be 2. Again, for 4 carbon atoms, you write bute. And you are mentioning this position because of the presence of triple bond. So you write ine. So the name becomes butyne. Now, these are when you're writing the structural formula, when you're writing the otherwise, if the molecular formula is written and you are just writing it butyne, it is perfectly okay because you don't know the position of the triple bond in the molecule. So you can straight away call it butyne. Now, butyne is the IUPAC name, but if you're writing the name of if you're writing the name in common terms, then you look at this molecule. This is known as C2H5. What do you call C2H5? Ethyl. And this is again acetylene. So the name, this was the IUPAC name. The common name will be, you will call this as ethyl. And because of the triple bond here, you will call it acetylene. And this is called, this one has methyl here, methyl here. So you will call it dimethyl, and this one will be referred to as acetylene. These are the common names. As I told you, not to apply any rules. But why I am telling you this? Because this is how you can remember. Otherwise, you are likely to forget. You will not remember why it is called dimethyl acetylene. Alright, so this was regarding the system of naming nomenclature. Now, we will talk about the lab preparation of acetylene. Lab preparation. As I told you earlier, lab preparation is very important, whether it is acetylene or any other hydrocarbon or any other compound. Acetylene is a common name of ethyne. Okay, so it is a very, very commonly used method. We use calcium carbide and add water to it, drop by drop, no heating required, nothing, cold water, room temperature water. Drop by drop, we pour it over calcium carbide, and this results in the formation of acetylene and calcium hydroxide. So what is done is, cold water is added drop wise through a Thyssen funnel into the conical flask containing calcium carbide. Okay. Now this also contains impurities like phosphine and H2S and arsine also, and ammonia. All of them have a bad odor. Okay, so what we do is, we pass this ethyne through water and all these impurities will be absorbed except phosphine. This phosphine will be absorbed by potassium dichromate. Okay, acidified. So acidified, I will explain once again. You add drop by drop, you add water to calcium carbide. This will result in the formation of ethyne and calcium hydroxide. This ethyne contains a number of impurities like phosphine, H2S, arsine and ammonia. If you know, all of them are bad smelling gases. With the result, this gas which is produced has garlic-like odor. It has garlic-like odor. Sometimes they also say that the odor is like goat's butter, anyway, whichever you remember. So it has got a garlic-like odor because of the impurities. By the way, before we proceed ahead, I would like to tell you the structure. If you remember, the valency of calcium is actually 2 and the valency of carbon is 4. So if you cancel them, this becomes 2. So the formula, don't you think, should be Ca2C? Why have I written it as CaC2? Why don't I follow this rule and write the formula as Ca2C? Actually, this calcium carbide is prepared by heating calcium oxide in the presence of carbon at a temperature of 2000 degrees. And this gives you calcium carbide and carbon monoxide. The structure is One calcium, which has a valency of 2, is linked to two carbon atoms, and the two carbon atoms have a triple bond between them. So that is why you call it Ca and two atoms of carbon, so CaC2. Okay, so you must understand that why we are not following the rule of the valencies, because this is how it is prepared and this is how the carbon atoms have a triple bond between them. That is how calcium carbide has a structure of CaC2. Alright, moving ahead. The second method which is used in the lab is known as dehydrohalogenation. Dehydrohalogenation. Now you already know the meaning of the term. Dehydrohalogenation of ethyl, this time dibromide. For the preparation of ethene, we had taken ethyl bromide. Now we are taking ethyl dibromide. Okay, so ethyl dibromide, I will show you the structure. There is one bromine attached over here, and another CH2 with which bromine is attached. So 1 2 3 4 1 2 correct. So ethyl dibromide, you will react it with two molecules of KOH, which is alcoholic. You all know the meaning of alcoholic. By the way, this is hot and concentrated. Hot and concentrated means hot we are referring to the temperature, and concentrated means it is the dilution is very low, the concentration is very high. So this results when we need to boil it, and this will result in the formation of C2H2 and 2KBr. We have two molecules of potassium. This potassium reacts with bromine, and another potassium molecule reacts with another bromine and forms 2KBr. This OH combines with one of the hydrogen atoms and forms two molecules of water. I will explain this once again. Carbon, carbon, two atoms, and this hydrogen here, and two atoms of bromine. When two KOH molecules, another KOH, when they combine, this potassium combines with this bromine and forms KBr. This potassium combines with another bromine and forms another KBr. Now this OH combines with hydrogen, this hydrogen, and forms water. And similarly, this OH also combines with hydrogen and forms another molecule of water. What are we left with? Two atoms of carbon, two atoms of carbon, and one, two, only two atoms of hydrogen. So one hydrogen here, one hydrogen here. To complete the valency, there has to be a triple bond between them. So this molecule is called ethyne. So this is dehydrohalogenation. These were the two methods used for the lab preparation. I will tell you one more method, which is the industrial method of industrial preparation of ethyne. This is prepared by what is called catalytic pyrolysis or cracking. Now here you take two molecules of methane and heat it to a temperature of 1500 degree. So if you notice, what is the difference? Earlier the temperature was 500, now it is 1500, and you use electric arc to generate this temperature. And this results in the formation of 1, 2, 3 and 3 molecules of hydrogen. So this is called ethyne. So methane, on thermal decomposition at around 1500 degrees in an electric arc, gives ethyne. So this is when you have to prepare ethyne on a large scale. Then we do this. Alright, in the next video we shall talk about the properties of ethyne. Have a good day, children. God bless you.